Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases, especially written for people learning English.
Today, we hear reports from Mario Ritter Jr., Andrew Smith, Dan Friedell, and Gena Bennett. Then, John Russell presents a new everyday grammar lesson. But first, students across the U.S. are protesting Israel's war in Gaza. Mario Ritter Jr. tells us how colleges are dealing with the demonstrations differently.
Police have removed encampments, released tear gas, and arrested protesters on college campuses around the United States. At Columbia University, New York City police twice came to the school to arrest those who set up camps and occupied a building to protest Israel's war in Gaza. Several hundred people have been arrested. Some students have been suspended and threatened with expulsion. Police are now stationed all day and night on campus. Early Thursday, police began to remove a pro-Palestinian encampment at the University of California, Los Angeles, UCLA. The Reuters news agency reported several loud explosions during the clash. Some demonstrators carried shields and umbrellas to block the police officers, shouting, "Push them back." Others surrendered and were moved with their hands over their heads by police. The arrests came one day after violence broke out between pro-Palestinian protesters and those who support Israel. Nearly 600 kilometers north, the situation has been very different at the University of California, Berkeley. Student demonstrations have taken place so far without arrests or disruption to campus operations. The contrast in how protests have developed at the top universities with long histories of student activism has been notable. The results show how college and law enforcement officials deal with events that can quickly turn into a crisis. Several other schools, including Northwestern University in Illinois and Brown University in Rhode Island, have avoided clashes between police and students. Education experts say these cases offer lessons in keeping tensions from rising. They say it is important for university officials to learn from experience and balance student activism with pressure from donors, outside groups, and politicians. Berkeley Chancellor Carol Crist has permitted students to maintain a protest space on campus on the steps of Sproul Hall since April 22nd. The building is where Martin Luther King Jr. gave a 1967 civil rights speech. Dan Mogiloff is a spokesman for Berkeley. He said, "The protest space remained in effect Wednesday in the hours after UCLA and Columbia called police. UC Berkeley has long experience with nonviolent political protest," Mogiloff said. He added that the school was following the University of California system's policy for demonstrations. That guidance tells college administrators to avoid police involvement unless it is really necessary. Police are to be called when the physical safety of students, faculty, and staff is threatened. That policy is not normal for most schools. Most universities have rules that bar permanent encampments or overnight student activities on campus. The University of California, UC, system has seen in the past where police involvement can lead. In 2011, during the Occupy movement against economic inequality at Berkeley, campus police hit students with sticks. Then-Chancellor Robert J. Bergenau later apologized, and the University of California system turned to the policy of restraint, spokesman Mogiloff said. Pro-Palestinian protesters are demanding that colleges end investments in Israel and in companies doing business with the Israeli army. In Illinois, Northwestern University reached a deal with protesters. The activists agreed to remove tents and sound systems on campus in return for a new advisory committee on investments. Protesters at Brown University in Rhode Island also agreed to take down their encampment in return for a vote by the college on whether to divest from companies tied to Israel's military attacks on Gaza. But some deals have failed to end tensions. Portland State University in Oregon agreed to suspend donations from aircraft manufacturer Boeing. Boeing is the U.S. company that makes attack helicopters used in Gaza. But students there have continued their occupation of the library. The Associated Press says the campus was closed on Thursday because of police activity. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Heavy rains and severe flooding have been hitting Kenya since March. They are among the most disastrous rainstorms to hit the East African country in recent years. At least 169 people have died from the heavy rains. At least 91 others are missing, the latest government estimates say. On Monday, at least 48 people died after water blew through a blocked river tunnel under a railway line in southwestern Kenya. The flooding has displaced more than 190,000 people and damaged roads and other structures. Seasonal weather patterns, climate change, and other natural weather events all combine to create deadly rainstorms. Kenya and some other parts of eastern Africa have two main rainfall periods. The long rains season from March to May and the short rains season from October to December. The long rains season is when most of the country's average yearly rainfall happens. In its forecast for this year's long rains season, the Kenya Meteorological Department predicted above average rainfall in many parts of the country. It also warned of flooding, landslides, and other harmful effects. Last year's short rains season saw severe storms in many parts of the country. The Meteorological Department said Lamu, Mombasa, and Garissa areas received nearly three times their long-term average rainfall. Kenya's rainfall frequency and intensity are affected by a natural climate system called the Indian Ocean Dipole. The Indian Ocean Dipole makes the surface of the western Indian Ocean warmer and then colder than the eastern Indian Ocean. It causes heavy rainfall in areas west of the Indian Ocean, such as Kenya, and droughts in Indonesia and Australia. Joyce Kimutai is a researcher at Imperial College, London. She said that, in Kenya's case, the Indian Ocean Dipole and climate change are likely bringing more severe rainfall and flooding. In a study in December last year, Kimutai and other scientists from World Weather Attribution found that human-caused climate change had made last year's short rains season in Kenya and other parts of eastern Africa up to two times more intense. It has become more difficult to predict long-term weather in Kenya in recent years. The start and the length of dry and wet seasons have increasingly changed. The Kenya Meteorological Department expects the long rains season to continue into June. In its latest weather report on Monday, the department said it expects heavy rain in six areas of the country. It also predicted flooding in low-lying areas and landslides in hilly areas. I'm Andrew Smith.
There is a place in Portland, Oregon, where people like to spend time enjoying food and drinks and watching sports on television. Places like it are called sports bars in America. This sports bar in Portland has an unusual name. It is called the Sports Bra, and it only shows women's sports events on television. A sports bra is a piece of underclothing that many women wear while exercising. The Portland Sports Bar is getting so popular that some well-known investors are getting interested. They include Alexis Ohanian, the co-founder of social media service Reddit. They want to expand the sports bra restaurants all over the U.S. Ohanian is also the husband of one of the world's most famous female athletes, Serena Williams. He runs an investment fund that will help business people open restaurants in their cities. Jenny Nguyen founded the Sports Bra. She said she only wanted to create a little restaurant. She is surprised by the interest in her business. Things have happened at light speed, Nguyen said.
The time appears to be right for bars like the Sports Bra because of the sudden interest in women's sports. There are other successful bars that only show women's sports but have different names in cities including Minneapolis, Minnesota, and Seattle, Washington. The recent Women's College Basketball Championship in the U.S. was the most watched ever. Almost 19 million people watched the final game on April 7th. For the first time, that was more than watched the men's final game. 1 week later, 2.45 million people watched the WNBA draft. The event is where professional teams choose college players to play for them. People wanted to see the Indiana Fever pick the University of Iowa's star player, Caitlin Clark. Clark recently signed a $28 million contract to advertise for Nike shoes. Interest is increasing for other women's sports. Almost 2 million fans went to women's World Cup soccer games in Australia and New Zealand last year. A women's volleyball game played in a football stadium in Nebraska brought in 92,000 fans last August. It was the largest ever crowd for a women's sports event. Lauren Anderson is director of the Warsaw Sports Business Center at the University of Oregon. She called the current time a pinnacle moment, adding that women's sports seem to be more than just a flash in the pan.
Wynn said sports bars were not always welcoming to women. A sports fan all her life, she said she would only go to sports bars with friends because she felt uncomfortable going alone. She remembered that people who worked at the bar would not always put women's sports on the televisions. She said she wanted to start the sports bra to flip the status quo. And now that the restaurant has been in business for several years, she has a favorite memory. It came in 2022 when a large crowd came to watch Serena Williams's final match. People cheered loudly when Williams made a good shot, and the whole bar was quiet when the players were hitting the ball back and forth. Toward the end, she said, many people got emotional, thinking that they would never see Williams play again. They started crying, and Wynn passed out facial paper so people could wipe away their tears. Williams' final match was on television all over the world, but fans came to enjoy it together. Wynn said, people were watching through the windows because there was not enough space inside.
But not every women's sport is easy to find. College and Olympic sports like water polo, volleyball, tennis, softball, and others are rarely on big TV channels. It can be costly to purchase a special TV channel that only carries smaller sports events. A place like the Sports Bra offers those unusual games for people wanting to see them. But not everyone likes going to a place like a sports bar to watch games on television. Joanna is a fan who was walking into a recent professional baseball game in San Diego.
I don't think I would go. I don't really like go and watch sports at bars. Okay. I'm more of like a live in person.
She was with Alex, who said he would probably go.
I mean, it'll be interesting. I mean, depends on like what sport I'm watching, you know, like because I do watch the WNBA once in a while. There's some on the TV. It's also like pickleball. Those are the co-eds and then the singles women. So, I mean, I would watch it.
One fan, Shreya, was standing outside of a sports bar watching the end of the Los Angeles Lakers basketball game on television. She said she would go to the sports bra, but said she wants to be sure it is not just a scheme to get people into the bar.
I mean, follow the WNBA, the local like soccer team, Wave soccer team. I have two girls, so assuming it has some sort of family-friendly vibe, like a restaurant and bar. Like, it would be cool. The reason for the pause was because I don't feel like it should be segregated. Like, I would want it to be at par with men's sports.
One expert agrees. Tarlon Chahardevali is an assistant professor at the University of South Carolina in the Department of Sport and Entertainment Management. Chahardevali said, "There is still work to be done to make sure the media market does not undervalue women's sports." She said, "There needs to be investment to be sure the current popularity does not disappear." "Today's numbers are hard to ignore, and I think it's a very exciting time," she said. I'm Dan Friedell.
And I'm Gena Bennett.
In last week's Everyday Grammar, we explored large numbers in the news. We learned about numbers such as a million, a billion, and a trillion. We asked our listeners and readers to write us messages about their countries. Today we give feedback on some of the messages we received. We will learn some ideas about English grammar. We will also learn a little about the world around us. Let's start our lesson with Afghanistan. An unnamed VOA Learning English fan wrote us two sentences about Afghanistan, both involving the large number, 40 million. The writer uses AFS, which is the plural short form for the Afghan currency, the Afghani.
UN announces $40 million aid for Afghan government. Every year, Afghan government spends almost 40 million AFS in education section.
We suggest adding a few elements to the first sentence. We can use the article the in several places. We can also include the short word in. Here is one way we might update the sentence.
The UN announced $40 million in aid for the Afghan government.
In the second sentence, we might change the final noun. Instead of section, we might use sector, which suggests a field of the economy. Here is one way we might update the sentence.
Every year, the Afghan government spends almost 40 million AFS for the education sector.
Now let's turn to a message about Turkey. Here is what Emra wrote.
People love to share their knowledge and ideas. Every day, 4 million of blog have been written, 80 million photos have been shared on Instagram, and 616 million tweets, which is meaning 7.1 thousand tweets per second, have been posted on cyberspace on Earth planet.
Emra wrote an excellent message. We particularly liked the first sentence. This is a great way to introduce an idea. We suggest organizing the rest of the paragraph so that the structures are parallel. We could change the verb form to the present. We also might slightly change some wording. For example, instead of saying 4 million of blogs, we might instead say 4 million blog posts. Here is one way to update the message.
Every day, 4 million blog posts are written, 80 million photos are shared on Instagram, and 616 million tweets are posted, a rate of 7,100 tweets per second.
Next, we read part of a message from Lukas in the Czech Republic. Lukas wrote one sentence for each large number, a million, a billion, and a trillion. We enjoyed how Lukas used a wonderful verb, hover. It means to hang over a point or to move around over a place. Here are the sentences.
The population of the Czech Republic has been hovering around 10 million for many decades. Billions of Czech crowns are sent every month to seniors for their pensions. Our country is too small to have a trillion of anything.
While the Czech Republic may be too small to have a trillion of anything, we imagine that millions, if not billions, of people would love to visit it. Let's end with a message from Japan. Ishii wrote,
on New Year's Day this year, a major earthquake struck the Noto Peninsula, located in northern Japan. The total damage is estimated at $16.6 billion.
Ishii's writing is excellent. We would offer a couple ways of changing the sentence so that it contains the same information. Our suggestions relate to style and not the substance of the first sentence. One choice would be this.
On New Year's Day this year, a major earthquake struck the Noto Peninsula in northern Japan.
Another choice would be this.
On New Year's Day this year, a major earthquake struck northern Japan's Noto Peninsula.
We were impressed by all the wonderful messages we received. We were not able to use all of them in this lesson, but some of them might make appearances in future lessons. If you have any questions or comments, please send us an email at learningenglish@voanews.com. I'm John Russell.
You just heard this week's Everyday Grammar lesson. Now, John Russell joins me to talk more about the topic. Hi, John. Welcome.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me on the show.
I noticed two reader messages involved the same correction, changing one word into two words. Could you talk more about that?
Absolutely. Our program is called Everyday Grammar. In this case, everyday is one word. It is an adjective meaning used or seen every day.
But there is also the structure every day, two words, as in, I go to school every day.
That's right. In that sentence, we have the noun day being modified by the adjective every, meaning some repeated activity or event.
So we might say, people post on social media every day. This means that people regularly post on social media. Every and day are two separate words in this case.
Right. And we might say that people use everyday language on social media. In this case, everyday is one word. It is an adjective describing language. What kind of language do people use? Everyday language.
Thanks a lot, John, for coming on the show to talk a little bit more about that issue.
Thanks for having me. See you next time.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Dan Novak.